I'll start off with a few questions and then we can bring in the audience. Before we get in the film, I'm wondering if you can maybe tell us about your first encounter with Merce Cunningham. What drew you to his life and work, and maybe how did he impact your attitude as an artist?
Right, so I'm originally from Moscow, and I came here in 96, and specifically trying to switch from linguistics to making cinema, and I got into... I had really hard time writing scripts because, you know, English was not my first language, and it took me a while to learn. So I started working with physical performers, and that's how I got interested in dance in general. And then I discovered, well, actually, modern dance and cinema were born approximately the same time, and the first filmmakers were incredibly fascinated by movement and action. And so I really tried to research a lot of this kind of collaborations between cinema and dance through whole history of cinema. And Merce was always interested in technology. I mean, he started experimenting with cameras in the 70s, specifically with Charlie Atlas, with film cameras, and then with video cameras, and then with motion capture, and all that. So I knew of him actually first, not from seeing his work on stage, but through the work actually that is called Variations 5. This was a piece that he did. It's an interdisciplinary, intermediate piece with projections by Stan van der Beek, and I think some of the representatives of that. Yeah, here you are. Thank you so much for letting us use the footage. So, right, so that's actually my first introduction to him. But I never thought I'm going to make a movie about Merce Cunningham, because he's the kind of choreographer who works in space. You know, he's very much interested in action space. So if you have 14 people going different directions, which shots are you going to actually make? You know, so... And then when 3D sort of articulated itself and danced through, especially when Pina came out, there was a kind of a commission or a grant through Dance Film Association from Rockefeller Foundation to make a film about New York-based choreographer using 3D technology. And I didn't think of Merce, and I was working on another project, but I went to see those performances of Merce Cunningham Dance Company at Brooklyn Academy of Music. They were the last performances, and that's the first time I was remember sitting there, oh my God, Merce in 3D could sort of something there happen. But I also was looking at the last generation of Cunningham dancers trained by him. So I felt like next month they're not gonna have any work. It was the end of the 2011, and they're carrying something that nobody else would carry. So basically I sort of, that was a big impetus. But I didn't know, you know, what I'm getting myself into. That was the end of 2011, in 2019 here today. But so I started researching, and the period that was most interesting to me at that time was about how Merce became Merce, really, that between those first three decades in New York. And basically for the next X amount of years, I had to become his friend, partner, and also kind of form this complex relationships, trying to understand how he was ticking. And through that process, I felt he experienced a lot of suffering and a lot of thrill. But what struck the most, and I think what kept me going for all these years, is incredible perseverance. I mean, I have never seen anybody in my life like that, even in a kind of history of art, in a way, that how much devoted he was to what he did, and also how open he was to things, because he would always say yes to things. So I think that idea of the spirit of generosity on the one hand and this kind of perseverance on the other really affected and made me mature as an artist myself.
So you just mentioned that this was 7 years in the making. Was this initiated by your decision to implement 3D, or I'm also curious to hear what that breakdown looked like over the years. How much time did it take to research and cull all of these materials from various archives and sources?
Yeah, I think if you divide this 7 years, I think half of it was actually making the work, and half of it was making the work happen. You know? So if we just had all the money and all the resources back then, we probably would have made it in 3.5 years or 3 years, because I think I... But it's interesting what happens, what time does to you. So I think originally we had quite a bit of development funds. So we basically went into it. So we basically me working with Jennifer Goggins, our director of choreography, and then Robert Swinston. Actually, the other way around, Robert came first, Jennifer then. And we basically looked at, 80 works that Merce made between 42 and 72, went through this rigorous process of trying to decide which works we should film, what's going to happen. So it actually all came from the work, you know. So that kind of first big, about 6 months period we had, and then we selected things, and then Mako and I walked, my DP and I, we walked New York left, right, and center trying to figure out what is actually we're going to do with all this work, how do we make cinema out of it. And that took quite a bit of time. And then we were actually, we had a rehearsal period in 2013 for 6 weeks full time, 6 days a week, trying to just teach this choreography to the dancers. And then we tried, we had a 3D pilot, like sort of a test made at the time, and it was clear we were trying to assemble our team, so it took a while. But then there was a big stop, kind of pause, and it was all about how do you try to convince the world that it's a worthy idea. And that also coincided with me trying to write a script about Merce through this research, and that took about 2 years. So we basically, in 2015, we shot the Some Space, which was the first thing we got through European co-production. So then that took us, that was quite, strong. We really did the piece we're going to use in the film. That's already like, 3 years later, pretty much. Yeah. And then, and with the script and the pilot and all that, we started going after figuring out, okay, the funding, and it went bad like this. So we actually shot on the, in 2018. But, the preparation for this project, for shooting itself, took an incredible amount of work, because we storyboarded everything, and we first storyboarded for New York, because we were thinking we're going to shoot in New York, and then we storyboarded everything for Germany again, so.
I'm curious to hear more about how you saw 3D as a cinematic tool to sort of express these performances on film. This was your first time ever really experimenting with 3D. I'm curious to hear what you were thinking about as you were going into it, and how that sort of changed as you started filming and going along. What sort of challenges came up for you, and what sort of unexpected benefits popped up as well?
People have all kinds of reactions to 3D. Some people like it or don't like it. It's really not about that. It's about what's good in 3D. And dance in 3D, you have incredible potential. Actually, anything that moves, if you look at the Olympic Games, if Olympic Games come on, everybody turns on TV, sales in 3D rise, because I think actually people are interested in seeing motion in 3D. And primarily because it gives you this kind of visceral impact, but also just neurologically slows down your perception. You come down, you actually settle in, and then you're able to see more, to take more, and so to register the action better and all that. So that we learned as we went. We didn't know, but it was exciting in a way, because on the one hand, it was exciting, on the other hand, we didn't know who to trust and or not. So it was a kind of process of finding the right people. And we ended up working with Josephine de Rob, who actually worked on Pina. And that was quite, helpful. But at some point, we just understood what it is. In a way, you just have to choreograph the eye of the audience. And that's what we end up doing. And also 3D really favors long, uncut shots. So it's almost like single camera approach, where you basically, every shot is one idea, and you choreograph it from the beginning to end. And that, of course, creates a lot of technical challenges, because you have to teach the steady camera what to do. You have to teach crane people what to do, so they all become part of choreography. So that's an incredible process. But in the end, I think you have an experience. I think if you watch this film in 2D, it'll be a movie. But if you watch it in 3D, which I hope you sense, is that it's just a different relationships to the image, and so you become part of the experience, or you kind of step in into it, and this proximity is very powerful, I think.
I'll just ask one more question, and then we can open it up to the audience. But sort of watching it again in the theater right now, I'm really struck by, beyond the 3D, beyond the costume and choreographer, is the remarkable attention you take with sound, to feel and hear the movement of these very nuanced gestures. Can you talk about how you thought about sound as you were dealing with all of this other technology?
Yeah, so I think, you know, movement never happens without sound. We always make sound when we move, whether it's so subtle or very concrete and obvious. So what I do, and Mako and I have been working now like since 2006, I mean, we always do so-called sound takes. So basically when it's the scene is shot, we shoot a scene one more time for sound. So the cameras are not running, but the sound is being recorded very close to the dancers. So because, you know, you can do a Foley afterwards, but you cannot find Foley artists, and you cannot simulate authenticity of the movement that these particular people can do. So we basically torture them. You know, I mean, they're really done. They don't want to do this. They hate it, honestly. But I'm very grateful that we beg to, you know, we ask, and then they do it for us. But not only for us, for the movie. And I think that really, really comes off. So when we go to the edit room, we already have all the sound takes, and sometimes multiple times. And then if we need Foley, we can do Foley, but it's only minor if we want some clap or something that's not quite, you know, articulate. And so then we have a lot of range to work with. We can make it very subtle, we can make it forward, we have a whole palette. So, and if it's recorded and by good people with a good sense of, you know, dance and movement, I think that comes through.
We can take some audience questions.
So first, just a experience, and then given how long you've spent with, you know, Merce, and, you know, love to get your sort of view on it. Cage was my mentor. I worked with him for many years, and I worked with John and Merce on Points in Space, so I spent a lot of time on that. And the orthodoxy about the two of them, you know, and it was in the film, you know, that they each went into their separate corners. You know, John worked on the music, Merce worked on the dance, and when it would come together in the performance, it was the first time, you know, you would experience that. What I saw was something very different, which was they were incredibly collaborative, and they had real opinions around what was beauty, and they loved each other, and so there was a lot of give and take. And so I guess my question is, from everything that you studied and everything that you saw, knowing what that orthodoxy, you know, is, do you feel that way? Do you feel at the end of the day, they were artists in almost a traditional way? There were things that were beautiful, there were things that were not, there were things that they liked, there were things that they weren't. And there was a collaboration of two artists. So I was just wondering if you have a feel for that through everything that you had seen.
I mean, I think they had a lot of periods, right? So I'm concentrating on one period where they just sort of find the language to work together, but at the beginning, right? And then it sort of goes in different directions. I think they never repeated themselves. That's, I feel that they were open. I think they had somewhat shared sense of aesthetic and somewhat completely opposite. I think at times they were incredibly close, you know, and at times they were absolutely so far away from each other. I mean, I don't have a sweeping statement about like were they collaborators. I think they were artists who shared a lot, and I think they trusted each other in their work. And I think when Rauschenberg says that it's like sort of a great way to be in a society. Nobody's really responsible, but everybody's not irresponsible. I think that there's a kind of a really great way to put it, because I feel like they were generally also interested in what will happen when they meet that first time. And they always said sometimes it worked and sometimes it didn't. And when they were willing to let that happen for things not to work. And that's incredible, because nobody can do that right now. You know, they could do it back then, but they could allow for things not to work. And then, but then they did work. It was a kind of masterpiece all the time. You know, so just, I feel like it's an incredible way of being and allowing yourself to be, I think. But I don't know whether they shared a lot of things, but I also think they didn't share a lot of things at the same time. You know, that, so it's a kind of, and it went waves through their entire lives because they had such a long partnership, I think. I don't know if it answers it.
Yes, way in the back.
Thank you for the film. I'm asking about the locations you chose for the dances, these remade dances. What was the principle to choose each of these?
Yeah, so I would say we don't capture dance, we create cinema, and I think that's the biggest thing for me, is that we try to translate Merce's ideas into cinema, and if you start with that, you would probably walk away from stage right away. I mean, for many different reasons. And what we did is we surveyed those kind of 80 works. Some survived, some didn't. We picked 14 out of those 80, and then out of those 14, we picked excerpts to work with. Now, behind each, Merce always started his dance with a physical question. So behind each dance, there was usually a physical question, and we would identify that question, and then we would think about how would cinema deal with that question. So for instance, if it's Winter Brunch, and if it's based on the action, on the action of falling, how would cinema deal with the falling? If it's about layering, like in Rune, how would cinema deal with that? So we put in the woods. If it's about falling, we put in the rooftop. If it's about confinement or togetherness, we create a confined space. We constantly try to translate his ideas into cinema and create this kind of synergy between what he was trying to do and find this kind of cinematic language to work with. And that's how those locations were basically chosen.
For the mic.
Thank you so much for delivering such an awesome film. So the way how you shot and staged the media pieces and dance pieces was phenomenal. My question to you would be, like, how was your thought process, like, during the 7 years or the overall period? Did it evolve, like, did it start from, like, what was the inciting incident or idea? So you wanted to, like, portray the artistic side of the artist, or you wanted to, like, portray the overall journey, or you wanted to focus on the art form. So did it evolve or change during the course of film?
No, I mean, it immediately, you know, there are so many films about Merce Cunningham. They're biographical films of all kinds. The idea was to create an experience of his work. So it all came from the work, and whatever we needed to add, to create context, to give insight, to sort of allow people to enter his work. That's what we used, you know. There are a lot of films about choreographers and dancers as people. There are very few films that about their work, because it's actually quite impossible to capture dance. Therefore, you have to find a way to create an experience of it, to translate ideas into cinema. So that's basically was the intention from day one, and it never left.
Unfortunately, we're a bit short on time. We have another screening starting here momentarily, but perhaps if there are more questions, we can continue the conversation in the lobby. But Alla, thank you so much.
Thank you.